All right, now we can start introducing some people. First, the division suit that covered basically all of Greer, which basically ran, originally I think he started somewhere near South Fork and went almost to 260, not quite. Did you go clear to 260, Tom? Yes, they're shaking their head. First is Tom Plymouth in the back. Raise your hand, Tom. Tom comes from California, right?
Yes.
Yes, Tom comes from us from California. He was basically in charge of all the engines and personnel that was in Greer and the surrounding area by Sunrise down towards South Fork. The division got smaller as the fire reduced and stuff, but he was basically in charge of everybody that was in the Greer district. Next to him is Joe Flores from Colorado. He's his trainee. In the far back, In the far back, representing the state forestry, Kevin Boness. And over to my left, over here that I keep referring to, we have Norm Walker. He's the current incident commander of the current incident management team that's running the fire right now. And then John Truer right next to him, who's his deputy IC. And I forgot Joe's last name, it just escaped me.
Reinerts.
Okay, Joe Reinerts was the incident management, or the incident commander of the Type 1 team. Everybody heard about the Type 1 team that was in here. Joe Reinerts was in charge of that. When they had to be pulled out here to go to other fires, they turned it over to Norm's team and he took over here. Saturday? Saturday's when they took over. That's basically all I have. I am going to open this up to questions and answers for myself, state. Oh, wait, I'm not done. Chris Knopp, I forgot. Chris Knopp, the supervisor of the Apache St. Graves National Forest, is somewhere back here. Oh, he moved over to this thing. Jeff wanted to ask something here, but we are going to do a question and answer. If you have questions for the Forest Service, for state, for myself, or for the incident management team, Norm can help, John can help, the guys in the back, Joe and Tom, they've been great to work with all these guys. We've built a good rapport for these guys, and it just worked like clockwork. Normally when you bring in teams from different parts of the country and stuff, sometimes you have turf wars and stuff like that, and you butt heads, but this whole team from day one to the transition of Norm's team to the guys in the back, we've worked like clockwork and kind of done it. Any questions or comments?
You briefly referred to the sprinkler system. Could
yes, sir.
You just expand on that just a little bit because it sounds bigger than what we thought of.
Okay, it's just not a garden hose running off your hydrant. Basically, like I told you, we have these folded tanks or pumpkins, as we call them, that holds anywhere from 1,000 to 3,000 gallons of water set up throughout town. They had a pump in them, or not in them, but they had a strainer that ran to the pump, and this pump could run for miles. Mark III pumps are made to run miles of hose. And what they do is they just run out these several hundred feet to half a mile lengths of hose. They would space out sprinklers about every 50 feet to 100 feet, depending on the radius that they would cover. And then they'd set them up in a chain. And they would put them around the structures that they felt were going to get hit by the head of the fire. So the fire would come in and those structures would be protected. And that is one thing I forgot to mention. Most structures are not lost due to the head of the fire. Most structures are lost due to spotting. It lands on pine needles in a roof, it lands on your deck. Somewhere like that. It's normally not the head of the fire. Shake shingles, whatever. It just takes one little ember. I saw an ember today that was probably, 2 or 3 inches in diameter that came out of the head of this fire and it was a mile away from where the main fire went. I know one of the information officers today, and holy cow, I forgot to thank the information officers, but they saw one that's about 6 inches long and about the size of a quarter. It was probably like an ember out of the top of a tree, a small branch or something that was, a mile or so from the fire, too, that was found, out into area where it spots. And that's normally what causes the structures to ignite, is something like that. And that's why they put the sprinklers mainly at the head to try to cool it down as it approaches those structures. In the back there.
Yeah, Mark, regarding the flooding, now we live up on Eastport. Are you thinking that the rains will wash down the mountain and damage to the basement stuff of our house, or are you thinking that the rains will cause the river to get bigger and bigger? That's going to be the problem.
It's actually both. Because of the fire, it's burned everything that holds the soil, holds the ground in the soil there when it rains. And the rains cannot saturate the ground through the ash and stuff like it does. So what it has to do is it has to run off. This hillside could potentially look like a river coming down here. It'll come across East Fork. It's going to wash everything that's on the ground, whether they're logs, sticks, rocks, whatever. It'll wash it into the river. The river's going to fill up and get wider. It's going to hit the bridges and the culverts where they're going to dam up, and they'll expand out from there. And Apache County is very aware of this, and they're as concerned about it as I am. In addition to law enforcement, that we're talking about the roads department, they've made aware of it as well. I'll get to you in a minute. Cor?
Is the water fine to drink?
ADQ, I heard, was in here taking some samples. I have not heard back. If you have a shallow well or a spring, I'd be a little cautious of it. That's one thing. There are several cases of water. If anybody is, you don't think you want to drink your water, let us know. We have several cases of water, and we'll get you drinking water. Anne?
Yeah, down especially in the south end, we had heard that you were going to be trying to bring in sandbags and all so we could start, because what we're hoping maybe to do is be able to sort of channel some of this that's going to be coming off the hills. Are there plans to bring in that? Or are we going to be getting any assistance from any kind of government agencies?
We actually received a 40-foot dump truck or trailer full of sand at the fire station today. Apache County is supposed to be getting us 20,000 sandbags. I'll get to you in just a minute. Did you have another question on the runoff back there? Did I not answer?
Yeah, I did. Of course, we have homeowners insurance. And I'm wondering, does anyone know whether, if your house is washed downhill, is that covered by...
You'll need to get flood insurance for covering that. And from what I hear, I'm hearing quotes anywhere from $2,500 to $6,000 for a structure.
That's what I heard too, but if it's 30 days before it starts.
That's correct. And that's why we need to get a hold of our government officials, Kyle, McCain, and Brewer, and get them to come in here. We can get FEMA in here and declare this so they realize how dangerous it is. Maybe they can do something to eliminate the 30 days and help reduce our rates.
Mark, my question is more for the Forest Service. I don't know, John.
We're going to put this to Chris in the back.
All right. Chris, after the rodeo at Chinescai fire, the trees were just left standing. They were like black telephone poles. And in 5 to 8 years, they fall down like pixie sticks all over each other. Are we to expect the same thing on these hillsides?
I think where you're going with your question is whether we could salvage any of that material. Is that right? We're going to probably, we've got a couple of things that we have going right now. And I think the concern you're mentioning of having a lot of deadwood falling down around the communities presents a hazard in 3 to 5 years. When the brush comes back, you've got all that wood down, we now have another fire hazard. So our effort is going to be to remove as much of that material around these communities as we can. One of the things that happened in the rodeo at Chinescai fire was we had quite a bit of litigation over those plans. And I don't think we're going to run into the same problem this time.
That was my follow-up question. Are we going to fight
but,
this to get this done?
I'm not going to take anything for granted in that respect. So we'll probably start off with a categorical exclusion type approach, which is something that I can do very quickly in order to get these emergency treatments in place and get that salvage logging accomplished quickly. I don't think we'll get appeals on that. But on a larger scale, there's many areas on the forest that benefit from that sort of treatment, and there's many places where you don't want to do that sort of thing. But that's a longer term look, and that's much larger acreage. That's where I would expect litigation on, if any occurs. But we had Senator Kyle, Senator McCain, Congressman Flake, and Congressman Gosar up here on Saturday. All of them had a pretty consistent message. Let us know what you need to make sure that we get that in the legal assessments accomplished so that we can get on with that salvage logging as quickly as possible. So that's our intent, is to move forward with that rapidly.
Thank you.
Mark, you mentioned the contact with Congressman. Is that something you want us to do individually, or is there something we can do as a group? Obviously, we have a bit of a fast track with John Kyle.
Those that know how to make contact, I'd recommend it. I know there's a lot of groups, and some of us will help me out here.
I'm Penny from Congressman Gosar's office, and so I can give you a phone number and an email. You guys can email directly.
Yeah.
I can give it to you, and maybe you can post it somewhere for everyone.
Okay.
Would that be fine? Would that be better?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions? We got mower. Work across the room.
Do you anticipate any flooding on the west side?
How far up?
260 on into Greer, I guess, on the west side.
Yes. It won't be flooding as much as will be the main street. What I foresee happening is the main street bridge right here at the curve where you drop into the village, that floods, and we will not be able to get emergency vehicles in here to help anybody should they be south of that. So, you know, as far as Crosby Acres, I don't foresee that, you know, being an issue out there because that wasn't affected. But those creeks and rivers, Hall Creek, Beanie, Rosie, all those could definitely catch some stuff from way up top that feeds them because there's fire up above them up there. So just how they feed into there, I'm not sure. And I'm coming across and, Dina.
Hi. Is there any plan for revegetation?
That's part of the Bear Group. And I do want to recognize a new group that started, so I'm going to have to help me out here, the Greer Wildfire Rehabilitation, something like that. But anyway, I recommend that group get in contact with the Bear Group and work specifically in conjunction with them. They don't want just anybody going out in the forest and planting and rehabilitating the forest. They want to work in conjunction with you. So take your volunteer efforts and help those and work hand in hand with this Bear Group. That's going to be your best way that we can help rebeautify Greer's working with them.
Will it be grasses and trees, or what is?
Chris, help me on the Bear, what they do.
Well, Bear is going to be a couple of things. There's going to be, the Bear is the burn area emergency rehab. That's going to happen in the next month. You're going to see a lot of aerial seeding, a lot of mulching, things like that. It's a temporary measure to try and control the erosion and the flooding. But then there's going to be a longer term aspect to it that will involve a lot more comprehensive things. There'll probably be planting in some of the extremely burned areas, but a lot of this area is going to come back pretty quickly, despite the fire. But there will be some areas where that's not the case, and we'll have to do planting.
Okay, and then the work group, or this new group that's forming to help rebeautify Greer, they can work on private with the private owners too. Gary?
When you mentioned shallow wells, how deep is you to the shallow well?
However, you feel it shallow and you're not certain about your water. Your area back there, Gary, wasn't affected as much. I'd say the ones that were in the right in the path of the fire that can, you know, that the fire burned around their homes. Yours, I'm not sure how, you probably have a shallow well. I would consider your well shallow, Gary. Did I have one on this wall back here at the bottom?
What?
You can, yes. Bonnie Stallings, I'm sorry. Bonnie Stallings from the EOC. You work at the EOC, right? Apache County Emergency Management.
I have many hats. For those of you who have probably seen me all over, I am Bonnie Stallings Carter. I am the liaison for this district. I also work with Supervisor Lee as his assistant. I just wanted to inform you that Supervisor Lee is very aware of what has been happening to all the communities. He's been attending some of the team meetings in the morning along with the Forest Service, the elected officials, city managers. County manager Dylan Wingert has also been attending these meetings. He is also on their project. So he is very aware of what our community needs are. And he has also been attending some of the meetings.